Good afternoon. Today we shall be discussing Girish Karnad's play Hayavadana. Hayavadana was written in 1971 and was Girish Karnad's third play, and is usually considered as one of the first modern Indian plays using traditional performance to receive national attention, and it established Karnad as one of India's most important modern playwrights. The play Hayavadana bases itself on the legend of transposition of heads. Although accounts of switching the heads of two people are relatively rare in myths, legends and folk tales of most cultures, Indian myth provides a fairly rich source of these stories. The most famous Indian example of this narrative concerns the origin of the elephant-headed god Ganesha. Fully human at first, he is beheaded by his own father, the ascetic god Shiva, in a fit of misinformed anger. When his mother Parvati learns of this mishap, she unleashes her own furies, as it were, who wreak havoc in all the worlds. To quell the mother's anger, Shiva restores her son to life by attaching the head of the first animal he finds, which was an elephant, to the lifeless body, thus creating the Hindu god Ganesha. Written around 1070 AD, Katha Sarita Sagar is a collection of many frame stories, each containing a multitude of short parables within it. One such frame story is that of King Vikramaditya, who is asked to fetch a corpse for a religious ritual. This corpse is, however, possessed by a demon, and the demon recites a series of tales to the king, each with a riddle at the end. If the king answers the riddle, then the corpse flies away from the king, but if the king knowingly remains silent, he will be killed. After 25 nights, the corpse demon proclaims the king's righteousness, helps him escape death, and rewards him with prosperity and divine wisdom. Among these 25 riddle stories is one which can be titled The Heads That Got Switched, which describes how a washerman, Dhavala, falls in love with Madana Sundari, the beautiful daughter of another washerman, and marries her. While he is enjoying the fruits of a happy marriage, Madana Sundari's brother visits them and requests that all three make a trip to the festival of the goddess Parvati. Dhavala enters the great temple of Parvati empty-handed and, in a feat of religious excess, beheads himself with the sacrificial sword as an offering to the goddess. Madana Sundari's brother discovers the beheaded corpse and, in his grief, beheads himself with the same sword. Madana Sundari becomes anxious when both men fail to return and enters the temple. Confronted by the horrific sight before her, she too decides to end her life and fashions a noose from vines in order to hang herself. However, the goddess, pleased with their devotion, stops Madana Sundari from committing suicide and allows her to bring the two men back to life by reattaching their heads to their bodies. Unfortunately, in her haste and excitement, Madana Sundari puts her brother's head on her husband's body and vice versa. The story ends with a riddle the king must answer correctly, which is, which of these two mixed up people is now her husband? The king replies that the one with the husband's head is her husband because the head rules the limbs and personal identity depends on the head, thus affirming the superiority of the intellect over emotion and spirit over body. After considering these two backgrounds thematically, we now go into the story of Hayavadana, the play. Hayavadana, as the name suggests, is a man with a horse's head, Haya meaning horse, and Vadana meaning face. His mother, a princess, had fallen in love with and had been impregnated by a stallion. Hayafatan is desperately seeking to get rid of the strange head when he stumbles onto the stage where the play about the transposed heads is about to be performed. The Bhagavata of the play then guides him to the same temple of Kali, where the characters in the play will get their heads transposed. This incident forms the introduction for the tale of transposed heads that follows. The main plot of the play begins with Kapila, who finds his best friend Devadatta despondently dreaming about Padmini. Kapila goes on to arrange Devadatta's marriage to her and realizes that Padmini is as clever as she is beautiful. Although Kapila is attracted to her, he nonetheless finalizes the match, and Devadatta and Padmini are married. The marriage is unhappy from the beginning. Padmini is herself attracted to the strong-bodied Kapila, and Devadatta is consumed by jealousy. A few months into the marriage, the three travel to Ujjain to a fair. On the way, they rest between two temples, one devoted to Rudra and the other to Kali. As in the other versions, the two men behead themselves in the Kali temple. The pregnant Padmini, afraid that she might be blamed for their deaths, then decides to kill herself. However, Kali stops her and offers to bring the men back to life. Padmini rearranges the heads so that Devadatta's head is on Kapila's body and vice versa, and asks the goddess to do her magic. Goddess Kali designedly comments that there should be a limit even to honesty and brings the two men back to life. In the confusion that ensues after the transposition of heads, Padmini makes it clear that she wants to be with the Devadatta head Kapila body. Her wish is granted by an ascetic who meditates the conflicting claims from both men to be her husband. The ascetic's decision is the same as that given by King Vikramaditya in Katha Sarita Sagara. With this new body, Devadatta returns to the city with Padmini and they begin a blissful marital life. At this point, Karna introduces two dolls that Devadatta presents to Padmini as gifts for the expected child. Through their own dialogues, the dolls describe the dynamic changes occurring in the family. They document the change of Devadatta's body from its rough, muscular Kapila nature to a soft, pot-bellied Brahmin body. They reveal that Padmini has given birth to a disfigured son and that she has now begun dreaming about Kapila again. The dolls also become the theatrical device through which Padmini sends Devadatta to Ujjain, so she can use his absence to sneak away with the child to the forest where Kapila resides. Back in the forest, Padmini finds the rough and muscular Kapila again. He is surprised to see Padmini and she reveals her desire for his well-muscled body. Devadatta, armed with a sword and the two new dolls, finds the lovers and the two men decide to kill each other since their love for Padmini cannot be reconciled. Padmini then decides to commit sati. She entrusts the boy to Bhagavata and leaves instructions for him to be raised both as Kapila's son and as Devadatta's son. Here the Bhagavata ends the story and Karna suggests in his stage directions that the audience should feel that the play has ended. However, the frame story involving Hayavatana begins again. An actor stumbles on the stage screaming that a horse has been singing the national anthem while another actor leads in Padmini's son, a mute, serious boy clutching his two dirty dolls. No amount of clowning and questioning by the actors elicits a response from the boy. Hayavatana returns to the stage now with the body as well as the head of a horse. Kali has answered his prayers, it seems, by eliminating his human physical characteristics altogether. Nevertheless, He still has human voice and is singing patriotic songs. Hayavardhana begins laughing when he sees the actors and Bhagavata. His laughter and human voice infect the mute child with laughter, and the child begins to speak and laugh normally. In a cyclic transformation, the child's laughter causes Hayavardhana to lose the last shreds of his human nature, and he begins to neigh like a horse. Karnad thus uses the logic of myth to create a double reciprocal exchange of functions that allows for resolution. Hayavardhana and the boy, in effect, complete each other. The one, as a human child, returned to the fold of society, and the other as a full animal. Clearly, King Vikram's solution to the riddle is interrupted in Karnad's play also by the intervention of another text interfering with the Vetala Panchavimsati, namely Thomas Mann's The Transposed Heads, A Legend of India. Thomas Mann finds King Vikram's answer incomplete by the logic that the head is the person. In Mann's version, where Devdatta, Kapila and Padmini bear the names Sridaman, Nanda and Sita respectively, sometime after the transposition, the head changes the body in psychologically revealing ways. The Sridaman head had proved its sway when Sita's wedded lord continued to dress his new body as he had the old and not as Nanda did. Again, he did not follow Nanda's practice of anointing his skin with mustard oil. His head could not tolerate this odor on his own person. Aparna Dharvatkar sums it up in her introduction to Karnad's collected plays. She says, in Mann's text, the supremacy of the head is both sustained and challenged far beyond the moment of crisis. The new bodies of the two men change inexorably until they are incompatible with the heads once again. Unquote. This idea is pursued in Hayavardhana pointedly when the reinvented Kapila, possessing Kapila's head and Devdatta's body, remarks that the body has memories as well, of which the head need know nothing. In a rare moment of lyrical outpouring, Kapila with Devdatta's body tells Padmini, one beats the body into shape, but one can't beat away the memories trapped in it. Isn't that surprising that the body should have its own ghosts, its own secrets? Memories of touch, memories of a touch, memories of a body swaying in these arms, of a warm skin against this palm, memories which one cannot recognize, cannot understand, cannot even name, because this head wasn't there when they happened. Unquote. What eventually happens in Hayavardhana is suggested by Thomas Mann as a logical result of the notion that the head alone can establish identity. Devdatta's head compels his body, originally that of Kapila's, to turn back into Devdatta's body, losing Kapila's manly vigor. The two plots in Hayavardhana, the outer that narrates the frame story of the man with the horse's head, and the embedded one that recounts the story of Devdatta, Kapila and Padmini, are linked in a self-reflexive manner. The frame play, in fact, discusses the issues of enacting on stage the story of Devdatta, Kapila and Padmini. Thus, a self-conscious reading is already inherent in Karnad's play. The play opens with the Bhagavata, the Sutradhar, the narrator, beginning to introduce the main or embedded play when he is rudely interrupted by scream after scream of terror coming from the petrified actor who has just encountered a talking horse. This horse gives the play its eponymous title, Hayavardhana, the being with a human body or a horse's face. By employing these frames, Karnad also prolongs the mode of conjecture generated by the first part of any riddle by examining the question, who am I, within two different contexts in his play. To conclude, Hayavadana subverts the sealed nature of the riddle principally by making context a way of generating meaning, making that meaning provisional, and making ambivalence central to meaning making. Thank you.